الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه أما بعد. We are still studying the explanation of this precious book, this Aqidah book, the explanation of the creed by Imam al-Barbahari رحمه الله شرح السنة. قال الشيخ صالح بن فوزان الفوزان حفظه الله تعالى وقوله يعني قول المؤلف أو ينكر شيئا الذي ينكر السنة عموما ويقول إنه لا يعمل بالسنة وإنما يعمل بالقرآن أو ينكر بعض السنة وهي الأحاديث الصحيحة ويقول لا يعمل بها وبعضهم يقول لا يعمل بالحديث إلا بالشرط أن يوافق القرآن وهذا باطل واتهام للرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بأنه قد يأتي بشيء يخالف القرآن فهذا القول لا يجوز. The statement of the author رحمه الله تعالى الإمام البربهاري, he said, or he denies parts of the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sheikh Salih bin Fawzan al-Fawzan, he said, the one who denies the Sunnah in general, umuman. And he says that we don't act upon the Sunnah. We act only upon the Quran. We implement only the Quran. We don't implement the Sunnah. Or he denies part of the Sunnah, which is some of the authentic ahadiths of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he says we should not act upon them or some of them, except if it meets a condition, and that condition that it complies with what is in the Quran. He said, this is false. This is false. Because now this individual is accusing the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he has brought something that clashes and opposes the Quran. And you know there are many of the rulings in the Sunnah that you don't find in the Quran. So I want to test you, brothers. I'm going to start first. And you tell me some of the rulings that are in the Sunnah that you don't find in the Quran. Like, for example, I'll give you one example. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he forbade a man to marry a woman and her aunt. Woman and her aunt. It's not permissible for him to marry both of them. Either he marries the woman, na'am, but he cannot combine between both of them. So this is in the Sunnah, it's not in the Quran. Okay, anybody has anything? Yes.
In the Sunnah, Prophet Muhammad
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
The different things that nullifies the wujud.
Yes. For example, Jazakallah khair, good point. The brother he mentioned, Brother Adam Jazakallah khairan, he mentioned when it comes to the nullifiers of wudu, نواقض الوضوء, السنة جاءت بأشياء لا توجد في القرآن. مثلا أكل لحم الجزور ينقض الوضوء. هذا ليس في القرآن إنما في السنة. Very good point, because you find out in the nullifiers of wudu, for example, if you eat camel meat, لحم الجزور, if you eat camel meat, then it nullifies the wudu according to the authentic hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but you don't find this in the Quran. Like, for example, if someone, fell unconscious, or this person becomes insane, majnoon, then we have the hadith. Also, likewise, the one who goes to sleep, that these are nullifiers of wudu. Like if someone, for example, went to sleep, he had wudu prior to that, then their wudu is nullified. They have to make wudu again. Likewise, if the person fell unconscious, they lost their wudu until they regain conscious and the like. And also when it comes to inheritance, right? When it comes to inheritance, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لَا يَرِثُ الْكَافِرُ الْمُسْلِمُ وَلَا الْمُسْلِمُ الْكَافِرُ, that the kafir, the non-believer, is not permissible for a non-believer to inherit from a believer. And it's not permissible from a believer for a believer to inherit from a disbeliever. Wadih? This is not in the Quran, but in the Sunnah of the Prophet. Likewise, the killer, the murderer. If someone kills his father to inherit, then according to the hadith of Prophet, if he killed him intentionally, عمدًا, لا يريتو, he does not inherit from him, because the Prophet, he said, لا يريتو القاتل, لا يريتو القاتل, the murderer does not inherit. Do you find this in the Quran? Don't find it in the Quran. طيب, because the Sunnah explains the Quran and explains many of the details of the Quran. That's why you find al-fuqaha, the Muslim jurists, Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i, Ahmad, and other imams of the Sunnah, you find out in their books of fiqh, they say, وَالْأَصْلُ فِي هَذِهِ الْمَسْأَلَةِ الْقُرْآنُ وَالسُّنَّةِ. And he say, and the origin when it comes to this issue, we have statement from the Quran and from the Sunnah of the Prophet. And sometimes they bring only the Sunnah. The Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like for example, when it comes to Zakat al-Fitr, you don't find how much in the Quran. You find how much do you give for Zakat al-Fitr in the Quran, do you? You don't find. Okay, sa', one sa'. Okay? Four handful, like this, four handful. That's called sa'. Four of these. This is called sa', which is about three kilogram and a half of rice, barley, and other than that. Do you find this in the Quran? You don't find it in the Quran. Likewise, you want to mention? Yeah, because I want tafa'ul. I want you guys to interact with me. You know, go ahead.
Another thing is how to perform Hajj.
How to perform Hajj. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, what did he say about Hajj? You know the hadith? خُدُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ خُدُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Take, learn from me your rites of Hajj. Okay, can you give us an example of some of the affairs of Hajj that are not in the Quran? Like what?
Between
Safa and Marwa. Like how many times do you have to go back and forth? It's not in the Quran. Ahsant. What about the tawaf? Do you find in the Quran it's seven times? You don't find in the Quran. Okay, what about the prohibition things? The prohibited things while you are in a state of ihram. Like what? What are the things that are prohibited? Mahdurat al-ihram. What are they? You cannot put perfume on once you assume l'ihram. Okay? But you can do it before. For a man, he could put a perfume on before he assumes l'ihram. Like for example, you reach al-miqat, right? You know, there's a masjid there. Like if you come in from al-Madinah, you pass by al-miqat, which is dul-hulayfa. Okay, now you get to the masjid there. They have showers, they have everything, you get cleaned up and everything. Then you put your perfume on, then you put your ihram. Now, let me ask you this question. Now when you get cleaned up, you put the garb, you know, the two pieces, like a rida wal izar. Rida, which is the top one, and the izar is the bottom one. Okay, now when you put them on, have you entered in a state of ihram yet or not? Huh? No. Correct. You have not. When do you enter into a state of ihram?
When you make the intention.
Ahsant. So, in other words, if someone put on the garb and he got an emergency call, they said, you know what? You have to come right now. We have a very emergency situation right now. Your mom passed away, your dad passed away, something like that. Can this person just get on the plane and go?
Yes,
yes he can. Does he have to expiate?
No.
هل عليه دم? Does he have to expiate anything like that?
No,
he doesn't have to do anything. Because he has not started that, yes, ihram yet. He has not assumed al-ihram yet. Al-ihram will be assumed once he makes the intention. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى. Now I have a question for you. If you have a child with you that has not reached puberty yet, like let's say the child is 5 years old. All right, so does this child have to perform Umrah al-Hajj? No. Okay, but can they perform Umrah al-Hajj?
Yes.
Yes, they can. The parents, do they get rewarded for that or not?
Yes.
They get rewarded. Due to the hadith, when a woman came to the Messenger of Allah and she raised her child, she said to the Messenger of Allah, does he have to perform Hajj? He said, no, but you have ajr. You will have reward if you do. If you take him with you and he performs Hajj with you, then you will have the tawab. You will have the reward. You see? Yes, when the Sheikh Al-Allamah Al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he mentioned when the child reaches, for example, 7 years old, right? And he reached the age of tamyiz. You know tamyiz, right? Discernment.
Huh?
Doesn't mean buluh. Tamyiz doesn't mean buluh. What is tamyiz? Anybody knows? Discernment. What does the age of discernment mean? What does it mean? Yes, exactly. Now he knows what's right, what's wrong. Okay, now this child, can he put his hand in the fire?
No.
He knows he's going to get hot. He's going to get burnt, right? Because now he reached that age of tamiz. Can he make the intention on behalf of himself?
Yes,
he can. So the parents, they don't have to do it for him. He can do it for himself. But, question I have for you. Like, at this age, 5 years old and 7 years old, let's say this child got sick and they want to dissolve of l-ihram. Okay, they were performing, for example, Umrah or Hajj, and then suddenly they got sick and they want to dissolve of it. Okay? They want to dissolve of l-ihram. Can he do it? Can she do it or not?
Yes.
Okay, do they have to expiate? Huh?
No, I think so.
You say they have to expiate?
No.
No, they don't have to.
They don't have
to. Why?
Because it's unintentional.
No, it's not that. Think about it.
Okay,
have they reached puberty yet?
No. Okay, yeah. No.
Are you talking about the parents or the... I'm talking about the child.
Oh, no.
I'm talking about the child. نعم. رفع القلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, رفع القلم عن المجنون. حتى يعقل وعن الصبي
حتى يبلغ
نعم حتى يبلغ وعن النائم حتى يستيقظ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, there are three individuals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not hold them accountable. One of them is al-majnoon, the insane person, until he becomes what? Sane. طيب, for example, somebody was majnoon, schizophrenic, something like that, bipolarism, anything like that. Then, at this stage, they are not required to perform the salat. نعم, حج نادا دا. Not because مجنون. He's insane. Okay, this person, as time went by, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he healed him up. And he became sane. Okay, now what happened to those salawat? The years of salawat and all that, does he have to make them up or he doesn't have to make them up?
No.
He doesn't have to make them up. طيب. So going back to the child, the parents, they will get the reward. for taking the child with them. They can carry the one, you know, who is young, very young, 3 years old, 4 years old, 5 years old, and the like. But Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen, he mentioned something very important too. He said the parents, they should not burden themselves with carrying their children. Because plus, it's a hardship. It's a big hardship on them. You know, all these kids come in there, and there's a lot of infectious disease. People get there and they get sick. And what's really amazing, which I cannot understand till now, I cannot understand this. Maybe you have an answer. Like so many people, they come to Mecca and Medina, and they're sick. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And they share this sickness with other Muslims. So if you have an infectious disease, why would you come to Mecca and Medina while you're sick like that? And then you share this disease with other Muslims who are healthy, you know? This is a big problem because this needs to be taken care of. Like the consulate in their country, they need to make sure that these people, they have taken vaccines and they have taken all the precautionary measures before they step into Mecca and Medina and get other people sick. يعني هناك بعض الناس يعني للأسف الشديد تجد أنهم عندهم يحملون أمراض معدية يعني ويدخل المكة والمدينة ويعدي الناس يعني غلط كبير هذا. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لا ضرر ولا ضرار, لا ضرر ولا ضرار. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said do not harm people nor should people harm you. So why would you come to a place of worship where there are millions, 2 million, 3 million, sometimes more than that. And then you get those people sick. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. نعم.
تفضل. Well, they're probably thinking along the lines that if making Hajj and all that is going to like wipe away your sins, maybe it could like make you feel like, make you better.
Yeah, but that's different from being sick and coming there. So if you have a contagious disease, would you go?
No.
Well, people go.
If that's the
only opportunity that they have, because now they're going to harm other Muslims. And they will be sinning more than gaining the reward. You understand? Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Naam. Sheikh, حفظه الله تعالى, he said, فهذا القول لا يجوز. The statement of this individual is not permissible to be said. وقد يأمر الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بأشياء ليست في القرآن. He said the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he may command us to do something that you don't find it in the Quran. And the Sheikh is going to give an example. مثل تحريم الجمع بين المرأة وعمتها والمرأة وخالتها. Like to get married to a woman and her maternal or paternal aunt. You cannot marry them together, like a woman and her aunt, whether she is from the mother's side or the father's side. It's not permissible to combine between both of them, to join two women in marriage, and the woman and her aunt. It's not permissible to join them together and marry them together. Either you marry one or the other. طيب. نعم. The Sheikh, he said, هذا ليس في القرآن. This is not in the Quran. He said, القرآن فيه النهي عن الجمع بين الأختين. He said, القرآن, you find the prohibition to join between two sisters. You cannot marry two sisters at the same time. But if you marry one and you divorce her, then you can marry her sister. But you cannot marry two sisters at the same time. This is in the Quran. وأن تجمعوا بين الأختين. والرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا يجمع بين المرأة وعمتها ولا بين المرأة وخالتها. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, it is not permissible to combine or to marry a woman and her aunt, paternal or maternal. طيب فيجب العمل بما قاله الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. So we have to act upon what the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم had said. قوله فاتهمه على الإسلام فإنه رجل رديء المذهب والقول. شيخ صالح بن فوزان الفوزاني سيد قائل هذا إما أن يكون من الخوارج وإما أن يكون من الجهمية والمعتزلة. He said, the author رحمه الله تعالى, he said, the person who makes the statement like this about the Sunnah of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, you must, he said, this person, you should accuse and have suspicion about his Islam. Because have you ever heard someone who is a Muslim saying a statement like this? You cannot like, well, this is very ajeeb. Well, a person say something like that. Naam. So the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, فَإِنَّهُ رَجُلٌ رَدِيءُ الْمَذْهَبِ وَالْقَوْلِ. He said, because this man is wicked in his madhab, in his methodology, and also in his aqidah, in his madhab, and also in his statement as well. So the sheikh, he said, the statement of this individual can be either from al-Khawarij. Anybody knows who al-Khawarij? Naam. Naam. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, Kilabun Nar. Kilabun Nar, the dogs of the fire. He said, سفهاء الأحلام حدثاء الأسنان. سفهاء الأحلام حدثاء الأسنان. He said, when he mentioned the traits of Al-Khawarij, their characteristics, their traits, he said that they are foolish in their thought and they are young in their age. So they're very foolish in their thought. Very foolish. Because of the lack of knowledge. They don't have knowledge of the Sharia. And they misunderstand the text. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he said, يَقْرَأُونَ الْقُرْآنَ لَا يَتَجَاوَزُ تَرَاقِيَهُمْ. They recite the Qur'an, but it doesn't go beyond their throat. Means they don't understand it. They don't understand the Qur'an, even though they recite it. And they have a lot of ibadah. So much so, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, يَحْقِرُ أَحَدُكُمْ صَلَاتَهُ إِلَى صَلَاتِهِمْ.
That would be the innovators, right?
They are innovators, yes. Al-Khawarij are the extremists. They're extremists. So Prophet ﷺ, he said about them that one of you will look down to his prayer in comparison to their prayer and his fast in comparison to their fast. يَمْرُقُونَ مِنَ الدِّينِ كَمَا يَمْرُقُ السَّهْمُ مِنَ الرَّمِيَّةِ. They leave the deen like the arrow that pierces through the game and come out. And another hadith, he said, لَإِنْ أَدْرَكْتُهُمْ لَأَقْتُلَنَّهُمْ قَتْلَ عَادٍ. He said, if I live to witness these people, I will kill them, the killing of Ad. These are the statement of the Messenger of Allah. They are very dangerous. They're very, because they look like so good. They worship, they fast, they recite the Quran to see, they deceive the commoners. They deceive the common people, but they cannot deceive the scholars and the people of knowledge. They cannot deceive them because they know their reality. The Sheikh, he said, وَإِمَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ مِنَ الْجَهْمِيَّةِ وَالْمُعْتَزِلَةِ. Or this person is from الْجَهْمِيَّةِ وَالْمُعْتَزِلَةِ. Who are الْجَهْمِيَّةِ? Yeah, Al-Jahmiyyah is a sect. It is a deviant sect. Some of the scholars, they even took them out of the fold of Islam. Al-Jahmiyyah, they are extremely, extremely, extremely deviant. Extremely deviant. They are far worse than Al-Mu'tazila. Far worse than Al-Ash'ira. Al-Jahmiyyah, they, from their aqidah, their belief, they don't affirm any name or attribute of Allah. They don't. Yes, naam. So they have shubuhat. They have some shubuhat. You know what shubuhat is?
No.
Doubts. So they have this shubuhat. They claim if they affirm the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this would necessitate that there will be multiple deities. multiple deities. You understand, Adam? What does this statement mean?
Yes.
What does it mean?
Meaning if they...
They claim that if they affirm... If, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says from his names what? And give me some of the names of Allah. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, Al-Salam, Al-Mu'min, Al-Muhaymin, and other than that. Naam, these are names of Allah. They Ahl-Sunnah, they affirm these names to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Jahmiya, they don't affirm. They have a shubha. They have a claim. They have a doubt. They say, if we affirm it, this would necessitate that we will have multiple deities. What do they mean by that?
When you say that, that means that there is multiple like gods.
Yes. And this is not correct. They are the followers of Al-Jahm bin Safwan. And this is not correct. Because Allah and Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim is the same. Those are the names of Allah. It's one ilah. He has different names, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what about the attributes? They don't affirm the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any attributes, they don't affirm it. Why? What's their shubha?
Because if they do that, then...
No, they claim if they do that, this is their claim, their da'wah.
And they, that's basically, they would say that's like...
Why?
Comparing him to a human.
Yes, they claim that if they affirm the attribute of Allah, this would necessitate that they would liken him to his creation. So what they did, they negated. Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, alhamdulillah. They affirm these names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they say Allah speaks in a way that befits his majesty. And Allah has a face that befits his majesty. And he has hand that befits his majesty and so on and so forth. والمعتزلة. Anybody knows the Mu'tazila? Who are the Mu'tazila?
Are they part of the Jahmiyyah?
They are actually, they are an offshoot of the Jahmiyyah.
Is it that they,
نعم.
Is it the state?
You can call them the chicks of the Jahmiyyah.
So they believe
نعم.
In the statement of the tongue and the statement of the heart, but they don't believe in the actions to be...
No, المعتزلة are those individuals that for example... They claim the Quran is created.
Ah.
Okay? They claim the Quran is created. But the Quran, la, not them. The Quran is the speech of Allah. Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they affirm that the Quran is the speech of Allah. And the speech of Allah cannot be created. Because the speech of Allah included His command, His commandment, subhanahu wa ta'ala. How could the commandment be created? And the speech of Allah, could an attribute of Allah be created? It cannot. Because the kalam is one of the attributes of Allah. Al-kalam, not al-qalam, al-kalam, speech. Kalam. So al-kalam is the speech of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the kalam is an attribute, right or wrong? Yes, the kalam is an attribute. And the attribute of Allah cannot be created.
It is on the Quran.
نعم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرُوا حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. If one of the mushrikeen comes to you for protection, give him protection until he hears the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Quran is not created. Likewise, they have denied that Allah will be seen in on Yawm al-Qiyamah. They said Allah cannot be seen. Why? Because they use two ayat from the Quran. This is their shubha. This is their doubt. So they say, for example, Allah said to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, "Lan tarani." Then tarani, you will not see me. Period. You will not see me. Okay, they use this ayah right here, and they use another ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "La tudrikuhu al-absar." Sight cannot encompass him. Okay. So how do you refute al-Mu'tazila now? How do you refute them?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
"Naam." faces on that day will be radiant looking at their Lord. طيب. That's a good refutation. What else?
That's a hadith.
No, an ayah from the Quran. What about the hadith? What about the hadith? Before we move to Brother Adam, what is the hadith? The hadith of Prophet sallam. إنكم سترون ربكم كما ترون القمر كما ترون نعم البدر لا تضامون في رؤيته لا تضامون في رؤيته. You will see your Lord as you see the full moon. You have no problem, all of you, looking at it. So likewise, the believers, they will see their Lord. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's in the hadith also. Okay, now, how do you refute their statement when they use the ayah from the Quran, لا تدركه الأبصار. Sight cannot encompass him. So they use this, they said, look, sight cannot encompass him, then he cannot be seen. How do you refute them? Anyone has a refutation against the Mu'tazila? Naam. No, from the ayah itself. You don't have anything. Brother Taha.
When you don't. The ocean, you don't see everything inside the ocean. You only see the ocean, but you don't see
Naam.
The
fish. Ahsant. Okay, now listen to this. Allah said, لا تدركه الأبصار. Pay attention to the wording of this ayah. لا تدركه الأبصار. Okay? لا تدركه الأبصار. Sight cannot encompass him. You see? He did not say sight cannot see him. Cannot encompass him. You understand? So he will be seen, but he will not be encompassed. You see the difference? Okay? For example, what Brother Bassam mentioned. You, for example, someone may say, I have seen the ocean. Did he encompass the ocean or he saw a part of the ocean? He saw part of the ocean. Did he see the coral reef?
No.
Did he see every fish in the ocean? No. But he saw part of the ocean. For example, someone may say, you know this book, do you know this book, Sharh Sunnah? So he says, رَأَيْتُهُ وَلَمْ أُحِطْ بِهِ. I have seen it, but I did not encompass it. Means I did not read all of it and know all the detail about it. Do you understand? And that's why Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said, there is not a single innovator that he use an evidence from the Quran and Sunnah, except that you find a refutation against him in that evidence that he uses.
So, for instance, when they say,
nah.
So that will be that.
Yes.
As in, sight and compassion, meaning that we cannot be able to see him. While in the same Sunnah or Surah, it is explained as the fact that we can see him, however, we cannot grab
nah.
the whole of him.
Yeah, about Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, we have an answer for them as well in that ayah that he uses. Because they said, Allah, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, I want you guys to answer. When Musa he asked to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, Len tarani. Len tarani. You will not see me. He said, you will not see me. Means Allah will not be seen. How do you refute them?
In this dunya, he will not be seen, but in the hereafter, he will be
What do you have to say?
Well, I know that he passed out when the light hit him and the mountain crumbled beneath him.
But they know how to refute the Mu'tazila. They're saying that Allah will not be seen in the hereafter.
Because we're not strong enough to see.
Wait. No, but we're talking about the ayah itself. Refute them from the same ayah they use.
What was the ayah again?
Because they're going to say, well, don't go there. We have a dalil here. You understand? How do you refute them? Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he asked to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah told him, لن تراني. You will not see me. They said, look, he said, you will not see me. Means that Allah cannot be seen.
Well,
ever. How do you refute that?
How would they know if he would see them? Because when Musa alayhi salam asked to see Allah, he was living. Like it was in this world, not in the hereafter.
Okay. What else?
And that he said, you will not see me.
Meaning in this lifetime.
In this world. Yeah. You will not see me in this world. Because he asked to see Allah where this world or next world? Here. So that's a refutation against them.
Right.
You understand? You will not be able to see me in this world because no one can see Allah in this world.
You're not strong enough.
And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, you will not be able to see your Lord until you die. In the hadith, Prophet ﷺ. You see, that shows you right there that Musa alayhi salam wa salam, he asked this because he was so, excited. He wanted to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He yearned to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say ishtiyaq, yearning to see Allah. But Allah told him, you will not be able to see me. In this world. Yes, exactly. Not in the hereafter, because in the hereafter we have the dalil, we have the proof that Allah will be seen on Yom Al-Qiyamah, as it is in Surah Al-Qiyamah and the Hadith of Prophet.
So the Mu'tazili, they use that statement to say that you will not be able to see him in the hereafter as well. Not only in this world, but not in the hereafter as well.
They're talking about the hereafter.
That's what they're trying to use that.
Yes,
okay.
They use that as a proof to say that Allah will not be seen in the hereafter. Exactly. And this happened here in this world. That you will not be able to see me in this world. But in the hereafter, Allah will be seen. Subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Allah make the mountain
of Naam. Yes. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammadin. وَآلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلِّمْ. Anyone has a question?
Also, the timing of the prayer is not in the Qur'an, right?
No.
Allah mentioned in the Qur'an, in general, he said, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. That the prayer has been prescribed on the believers on fixed times.
But it doesn't tell you.
But it did not mention the detail. Ahsant. Jazakallah khair. Naam.
Also, how much zakat?
Yeah, the zakat. Yes, the percentage and all that.
And how to pray?
Yes, how to pray? Yeah, many details. They're not found in the Quran. They're found in the Sunnah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Nobody has a question? Okay. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Walhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammadin wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim.